the roaring 20s, the era of wonderful nonsense, anything goes, flappers, bathtub gin, prohibition, speakeasies, Benny sent me, stock market going crazy, flappers, the Charleston, you name it, the roaring 20s captures a lot of images and a lot of good times in certain people's minds, as well as gangsters, Al Capone, Machine Gun Kelly, and all the other notaries that go along with that time period. We're going to take a look at the Roaring 20s, see if in fact it was roaring and what it eventually led to. Yes. Charleston.
The 1920s, the roaring 20s, the jazz age.
Starts out with a bang and it ends with a thud. Stormy weather. All the things I thought were gone. So, what was the Roaring 20s? What exactly was going on? And beneath that exterior, what was really behind it? So, we've got an era of mass introduction of the Model T and the card, movies all of a sudden become a big deal. Charlie Chaplin right there in the champ. New things called refrigerators will replace the old style ice boxes. Though as a kid, I called them ice boxes up until I got married. Yeah. Republicans would rule, literally rule the era. With the end of Woodrow Wilson and, of course, progressivism and the beginning of Warren G. Harding, you're going to have three straight Republican presidents. And there's going to be conflict. Again, between, or I should say behind that calm exterior, just like in the Gilded Age, there was a rotting carcass just waiting to collapse. Prohibition is going to help bring that along, and so will intolerance, pictured, of course, by the reemergence of the Ku Klux Klan. The Jazz Age, the Roaring 20s, call it what you will. It is an era of great change. The predominance of the agricultural, the countryside was starting to slip. And we saw that with the rise of populism in an attempt to make sure that farmers would keep center stage. Of course, that's not going to be the case. With the rise of progressivism, it will be the urban environment that's going to dominate society. And by the 1920s, the census reflected it, that there were more people in urban areas than there were in the countries. We had, compared to the rest of the world, a much higher standard of living. And that doesn't mean that everybody was enjoying it. It just means, generally speaking, the average American was doing okay. We're going to see, because of the end of World War I, left a lot of countries in the lurch, the economic expansion of this country is going to increase by leaps and bounds. Money and millionaires seem to be literally growing on trees. It'll be the era of mass production. Gone would be the craftsman making each individual item and all of them superbly engineered and a little bit different. This is not going to be the case. With the advent of mass production and the assembly line, the factory and industrialization, which we've talked about since the end of the Civil War, is going to come into play. There you see, of course, the assembly line as pictured and then eventually introduced by Henry Ford. Ford's production of the Model T, making it an item which was in the grasp of the average American in terms of price, is now going to be the standard for all industries, not just the Model T, not just the car. Agriculture will be the one that's going to suffer. And keep this in mind. Farmers are generally the litmus test of how the country is doing. And that would be the case up until the 1960s, 1970s. Then it was going to be something else, home building and the car industry. But back then it was agriculture. If the farmer wasn't doing well, then eventually that was going to spread to the rest of the country. So here's what we're going to take a look at. The role of technology and in shaping the economy and the culture of the country. We'll take a look at big business and government, which of course we've already touched upon, and the automobile. Of course, part of that new technological change and how it's going to affect the economy and the way we live. So, the decade of the 20s saw this. 43%, think about this, 43% of everything in the world was made in this country. Matter of fact, after World War II, it's going to jump to 50% of everything made in this country. That's an incredible statistic. But that's not going to last in either decade. Republicans, Warren G. Harding, Calvin Coolidge, Herbert Hoover, are all going to play a role in the 20s, either as villains or as inept stewards of democracy. That man right there, Warren G. Harding, will run against James Cox, the Democrat. Cox, and I've mentioned this to you before, would choose as his running mate Franklin Delano Roosevelt, FDR. He soon to be of presidential fame. It would be a vote on Wilsonism and the desire to join the League of Nations. And of course, what Harding talked about was, if you remember, a return to normalcy. Harding runs. Alice Longworth Roosevelt, or actually it's Alice Roosevelt Longworth, she married and their husband died. We can talk about a number of reasons for that. Anyway, she's the daughter of Teddy Roosevelt. She was asked what Harding brought to the table. And she said, well, I can only think of one thing, a good personal appearance. He looks like a president. Of course, did he act like one? That's another story. When he gets into office, Harding, who himself is a decent man, surrounds himself like a previous Republican president, that would be Ulysses S. Grant, with a lot of people that have some ulterior motives other than serving the electorate. And as he said prior to his death, I have no trouble with my enemies. I can take care of my enemies in a fight. But my friends, my goddamn friends, they're the ones that keep me walking the floor at nights. he would eventually die of a heart attack in office. Much of it caused by the stress of the constant issues that are going to be brought before him, issues of corruption which existed within his administration, more so than any previous administration and future administration, well up to perhaps the current one. The scandals and corruption were a myriad of things. He had, to begin with, a poor cabinet. Some of them would wind up going to prison. There would be a rather controversial book published. Sound familiar? Called The President's Daughter. And it talked about a daughter that he had an affair with a woman. She got pregnant, had the daughter, and her name was Nan Britton. Well, of course, this was a scandal back in that day, particularly in the 20s with the rise of born-again Christianity. You're going to have this man, Charles Forbes, a member of the cabinet, convicted of corruption. You'll have the advent of the Teapot Dome scandal, which we'll talk about briefly. And then you'll find the Attorney General of the United States accepting bribes in order to look the other way during this era of prohibition. There was so much corruption. Take a look at that political cartoon where you saw that everything was for sale in Washington, D.C., whether it was the White House, a senator, Congress, the Washington Monument, everything could be bought. Everything had a price. And that was the people's view of Washington, D.C. at that time. Literally, to coin a phrase, the swamp. Now, the Republicans, of course, are the ones that are in power during this time period. And Harding is going to be at the center of it. But again, keep in mind, with this legacy of scandals, which taints and colors his administration, he personally was not involved. And that leads to an old axiom. You want to be a great president, you need to surround yourself with great people. You go all the way back to Washington with his all-star cabinet of Jefferson and Hamilton and his vice president, Adams. You go to Lincoln, who surrounds himself with superstars to get through the Civil War. You're going to find the same thing later on with Franklin Roosevelt, and the list goes on. Great presidents surround themselves with great people. Harding surrounded himself with incompetence and crooks. Sound familiar? Now, the Teapot Dome scandal. What exactly did this involve? His Secretary of the Treasury, Andrew Mellon. Some of you may have known his brother, Walter. Andrew Mellon, his brother, Walter Mellon. Anyway, he showed his favoritism towards the rich. And again, he's going to get caught taking some bribes. Under Harding, there would be a high tariff. Now, the high tariff was to protect American industry. It was, if you will, economic isolationism. But here's the problem. As you see there, the second half of that sentence says, we also insisted that they repay the loans that we gave them, they being the Europeans, prior to and during World War I. Well, if they can't sell goods to the United States in order to get the money to pay off the loans, then how are they going to do that? And that's going to help plunge them into economic chaos. Harding's cabinet and other members of his administration would get the nickname the Ohio Gang, because most of them are his cronies from the great state of Ohio. And of course, his oratorical clumsiness rivals another Republican president. Let me Well, I don't know if Harding would trump the current president with his malapropisms, but who knows? He's going to be replaced by Calvin Coolidge. Let's go back for just a second. Let's take a look at the Teapot Dome scandal. I've mentioned it to you a couple of times. Basically, what this was the Secretary of the Interior. Now, I want you to follow the bouncing ball here. The Secretary of the Interior took the money that was being made by the United States, and that money was coming from land that the United States government owned. We owned it, and on that land was our oil reserves. Mean by that? Well, oil reserves are simply oil that we have stocked up, if you will. Think of it in terms of a bank of energy, so that if for some reason we ran out of oil or we needed to slightly lower the prices of oil for the American people, we could release some of those reserves. So we always had something to fall back on. It's like having a savings account, if you will. Well, what happened was our Secretary of the Interior, part of the Ohio gang, takes the oil reserves and leases them, follow this now, leases them to big business, namely oil companies such as Standard Oil, later to become known as Exxon. Sound familiar? So then what do? They then take the oil, which was ours, and they sell it back to us. So the government leases the land on which our oil is, and then those big businesses take that oil, sell it back to the government at a much higher price. So it not only covers the lease, they make a profit, and we're paying much more for oil that was already ours. And eventually, that would all come to an end. This man, Calvin Coolidge, sometimes known as Silent Cal, is going to take the place of Harding when Harding dies. Coolidge is a New Englander, originally from Massachusetts, was visiting his father's hunting cabin in Maine when Harding dies. And with the advent of Coolidge comes the death of progressivism. He is given credit for a statement which perhaps he didn't really say, but it was his attitude. The business of America is business, pure and simple. Laissez-faire is back. Let it alone. Coolidge rarely said very much, which is why he got the nickname Silent Cal. Matter of fact, the story goes that one time at a party, a woman goes up to Coolidge and says, "Excuse me, Mr. President, I have a bet with that gentleman over there, and the bet is that I can get you to say three words." Now, of course, she's hoping he's going to say, "No, you can't," which, of course, would be the three words. Coolidge turns, looks at her, and says, "You lose." And that was it. Two words, she loses the bet. The business of America is business. And who does he keep as his Secretary of Treasury? Well, the businessman's businessman, Andrew Mellon. So there's not going to be any government control on big business. They are going to run wild, particularly in the area of the stock market. And he's going to take that high tariff and raise it even further, putting us behind a wall of tariffs. Meanwhile, the American farmer, the barometer that I told you to watch, was suffering from his own greed, if you will. Remember, World War I saw Europe incapable of providing its own food, so they turned to the United States. Now, it's also World War I. we're going to put a few million guys in uniform. An army, remember, travels on its stomach. So now what happens? These guys start, just as the farmers during the Civil War did, and they suffered the same fate, they start over farming. They start mortgaging their farms to buy equipment that they can't afford. But the idea is we can make more of it, we can make it faster, and we can sell it and make a profit and cover our debts. But in over farming, they are killing the land. They're not following any environmental safeguards in order to ensure that the land is going to be theirs for a long, long time. They are literally killing it. And so an agricultural depression will hit in the early 20s, far ahead of the Great Depression that is on its way. Europe starts making its own food. Part of the reason is because of the tariffs. They can't get the money to buy American food, so
they grow their own.
There it is, the mechanization of the American farm. They can dig down deeper in the soil, and that soil is going to become loose. Now keep that in mind, loose soil. So when the great winds come during the era known as the Dust Bowl, that soil is going to blow away, and it's not going to be capable of what's left of sustaining anything. So the bankers start pulling their loans. Any farm is going to be repossessed, putting these gentlemen literally out of home, out of a job, out of So the Great Depression for them has already begun. When the rest of the country joins them, of course, that just further worsens the blow. Black Americans in this period continue to live in poverty. You're going to find a couple of things happen. Down the road, you're going to find that when programs are put in to help the farmers that suffered during this era, and keep in mind, most African Americans at this time were still in agriculture, right? Those programs would discriminate against Black Americans and not allow them to participate in the programs trying to renew the farm.
Come and listen to the story about a man named Jay.
Keep them down on the farm. Sharecropping, which is what many of them participated in, became in effect economic slavery. They again promised to share their crops or the profits from their crops with the owners of the land, as they, the sharecroppers, leased the land so they could grow something. But of course, the price kept going up and up. So basically, almost all of the profit from their crops was going to the person that they rented from. And they couldn't leave until they paid all their debts, which meant, in effect, they were slaves. And then, in the mid-1920s, that little critter causes a problem. That's the boll weevil, which decimated the cotton crops. So, white landowners go bankrupt. Now, blacks are forced off their land because that land is going to be taken over by the banks. So they become, in effect, homeless. Now will begin the Great Migration. Blacks, African Americans moving to the north, moving to big cities. Most of the newly freed slaves at the completion of the Civil War stayed in the South. But there will be a couple things that are going to push them out of there. Number one is what we just talked about, and that, of course, is going to be the economic depression that they're faced with. Combination of the attack of the boll weevil, dropping prices, etc. The second thing, as we're later going to see, will be the rise of violence in that area. Lynchings by the thousands are going to take place. And once again, the government, starting with Wilson, does absolutely nothing to stem that tide. So they're going to leave the South and again head north to cities where they could possibly find jobs in America's factories. Very few are going to go out west because that took money. So this becomes known as the Great Migration. It will continue all the way through World War II. Now again, don't forget, 1916, 1917, we are going to start gearing factories up for war production. So there were jobs at that time, but those jobs are not going to last. Other economic problems that were knocking on the door. There's going to be fraud in Florida, where swamp land is going to be sold, forcing a lot of people into bankruptcy. Securities corruption. We're talking about the stock market. You're going to find the rise of mass consumption, meaning that mass production, making a lot of something, needs a lot of people to buy that lot of something in order for this cycle to continue. But if money becomes short, well, you can see which way those dominoes are going to fall. In the auto industry, which is going to start employing more and more people, you're going to find that the few are going to dominate, the big automakers. That, of course, will be Ford, followed by General Motors, and then, of course, Chrysler. They will dominate the industry and leaving no room for anybody else. Stock speculation was rampant. And it was anything goes. Buy stock, buy it high because you're going to be able to sell it at a higher rate. And it would turn around in not just a matter of months or weeks, in days. So everybody, and I mean everybody, was participating in that. Rise of the super corporations, which sold something that Ford started, and that was buying on credit. When cartoons, and we're talking about animated cartoons, start hitting the movie screens, one of the big hits is early on is going to be Popeye the Sailor Man. And Popeye had a buddy by the name of Wimpy. And Wimpy coined the phrase, "I gladly pay you Tuesday for a hamburger today." That was the example of credit buying. This flew in the face of that old New England work ethic where you could only buy what you could afford. Now, I buy it today with money that I want to make tomorrow. And a lot of this is going to be pushed by the rise of a new industry, advertising, which in the beginning will be headquartered on something called Madison Avenue, which, of course, is in New York City. So you have the Madison Avenue types who would be able to sell anything. First, it would be products. Later, it would be organizations. And then it would be even sell people to the American people to become presidents. So end of the Protestant work ethic and the beginning of buying on credit. Take a look at what you could buy. Take a look at how it was sold. Out of the cold, sorry, Guarding General Electric, J.P. Morgan. So that was the way they sold. And again, notice who was the target of that. And that, of course, was women. Women were the fuel that fed the economy. Men would be targeted for cars, but for everything else, for all these newfangled gadgets, it was women. We were fast becoming a consumer economy. New washing machines, new gas stoves. No longer would you have to put wood in or coal to keep them going. Electric tools. And of course, the ever-present refrigerator. You have to have one, whether it be the toaster, the telephone, the waffle iron. Yes. Even dentists were getting new machinery. And of course, the iron. Again, all things to make the woman's job simpler. And of course, as that hackneyed phrase goes, a happy wife means a happy life. So husbands, get out there and earn that money so that we can pay for these new gadgets. This is what we mean by a higher standard of living. Much of these things were not available overseas. But it would be the car that would have the single biggest impact. Now, allowing Americans to travel, not just in the immediate vicinity, but across the country. And of course, what Henry Ford was going to initiate would be installment buying. It's the very thing that exists today. You put a down payment, and then every month you're paying another installment. And of course, they were all to buy his Model T. These Model Ts were going to lead to the increase of white-collar workers, because as more industries grew up, now again, think about it, most of these industries were in the cities. And as the cities got too crowded, people started to move out into what would later be known as the suburbs. Now, why could they move out there? Because of the car that helped create some of these industries. Now think about it. Think about everything that goes into a car: rubber, steel, glass, plastic, and the list goes on. Gas, which of course comes from the oil industry. So all these industries would be fueled, just as the car would later be fueled, by the car. So with their Model T, they could move to the suburbs and commute into the cities. And this is a trend that was going to continue for quite some time. This was the second industrial revolution, and Henry Ford would start it in 1903 with his assembly line. They, of course, took something from Eli Whitney, which Whitney, of course, the inventor of the cotton gin, but the most important thing that Whitney came up with was not the cotton gin, which of course was going to change the face of America, but it was a system of interchangeable parts. And that's exactly what Ford's going to take it on to bring about his assembly line. Take a look. Thank you.
very few roads back then. As tough as Europe, and was fit.
Henry Ford once said that any man should be able to buy a car, and he was going to mass produce the Model T, and you can have it in any color you want as long as it's black. The average Model T sold for about $200. One time, a man was asked, "I see you got a car, but you don't have a bathtub." So the guy looked at him with a quizzical look and said, "Well, easily. Why? I have a car. Because you can't go to town with a bathtub." Well, there you go. The introduction of some cultural changes. Women, now with all of these newfangled modern conveniences, had a little bit more free time. Women are moving to the city. They now have the right to vote. This will begin the introduction of...
Hello, baby!
The flapper. Now, this gets a little bit more press than perhaps it should. And the reason I say that is because the impression is that most women were flappers, and that's not true. You had a lot of them that were. They primarily lived in cities, but the bulk of women were not members of this flapper generation. That's like saying that every person that grew up in my era of the 60s was a hippie, and of course that's not true. But they definitely... both the flappers and the hippies did catch the media's eye. Remember, 19th Amendment gave them the right to vote, giving them a certain feeling of independence. Women now, because of labor-saving devices at home, had a little bit more time to go outside the home and work. We saw that with the first Industrial Revolution, where teenage girls were no longer needed at home to work as the market economy came into place. Well, now those teenage girls, of course, went out to work. Well, now women could also do the exact same thing. More women would go to college. Now, again, I don't want to overstate that. Ah, yes, the new woman. Short hair, short dresses, smoked in public. My God, what's the world coming to? Yes, the typical picture of the Roaring Twenties. By the music of the era, one of the reasons why it was called the Jazz Era.
Hey,
go. And a lot of the musicians were African Americans. Going into Harlem, going downtown, was a big trip for a lot of people during this age. So culture is going to be influenced by another technological innovation, the introduction of the radio. ABKA would be the first radio station in America. It would take place in Pittsburgh, and the first thing that it broadcast was a presidential nominating convention. Beginnings of new technological corporations, GE, Westinghouse, RCA, and eventually NBC. Charlie Chaplin becomes a movie star during this time period, though later he's going to be forced to flee this country. Al Jolson, the jazz singer, will be the first movie star, if you will. He will be the first man to appear in a talking motion picture. Movies at that time were silent, with Charlie Chaplin playing the kid. Talkies would be introduced in the 1920s. And you see there the movie The Jazz. Ah, yes, Mary Pickford, the darling of the age. He becomes, as you see there, America's sweetheart. And this would be the first cartoon. Beepo Willie. Steamboat Willie would, of course, later turn out to be, yes, that's right, Mickey Mouse. So the first animated cartoon, Steamboat Willie, Mickey Mouse, and that began the career of a young man by the name of Walt Disney. NBC, first radio network, 1926, and the average annual movie attendance, 90 million. Now, may not sound like much. Keep in mind, at this time, there's only maybe 120 million people in the country. So almost everybody went. Now, one of the things, of course, that made it really popular was the movie theaters were air conditioned. So even if you didn't like the film, to get out of the heat, you might go to the theater. Everybody gathered around the radio. Here, the various shows that were being played, whether it was gangsters or cowboys or horror shows, one individual decided to play a little joke on Halloween. And that, now, of course, this was in the 1930s, and he proceeded to tell everybody how the Martians were invading Browns Mill, New Jersey. And that, of course, would lead to a panic nationwide, and later would lead to a number of other things for a man by the name of Orson Welles, who produced that show. the Harlem Renaissance and an individual that was called the New Negro by that man, Langston Hughes, one of the famous African-American authors of the time. He helps coin the phrase, the Harlem Renaissance, which highlighted Black culture and its growth, particularly in that area of Harlem. Marcus Garvey would be an entrepreneur, an African-American entrepreneur who pushed Negro nationalism, Black-owned businesses, et cetera, et cetera. Garvey starts what you see there, the UNIA, United Negro Improvement Association. He also starts a shipping line where he makes some promises that he can't live up to. Eventually, he's going to be accused and convicted of defrauding a good many people. One of the sad chapters in all of this will be the failure of an anti-lynching bill in Congress. I mean, murder was already illegal, and that's what lynching is, it's murder. But they wanted to make it a federal crime because they knew that no southern state was going to prosecute, and it could not pass in Congress.
One of the things that's burbling up in the streets is jazz. And what's not to like? It is the spectacular efflorescence. I mean, jazz is not a New York phenomenon, but in the 20s, Black musicians come pouring into Harlem. You're getting to hear the most spectacularly fascinating, exciting music that the country had ever produced.
This was where a European, when Ravel came here, where did he want to go? And he told George Gershwin, take me to Harlem. Gershwin, of course, took him to Harlem where he was just, you know, his socks were knocked off by the music. And European composers would come here and then tell the press at home, their home as well as here, this is the music. This is the most exciting music being made today.
By 1924, Black writers, poets, artists, and musicians from around the country were pouring into the new Black city within a city. Drawn by the presence of the media, by exploding opportunities in the entertainment industry, and by the siren call of Harlem itself.
African Americans had never had a space of their own in New York City. There had been little concentrations, but they were by streets, and consequently they were readily and easily moved. So you had Blacks really caroming around town from way down in the lower part of the city up to Greenwich Village, and the Italians come in and they carom off to San Juan Hill and the Tenderloin. The subway system, which runs on up into Harlem, opens up a new possibility, an escape route. And although there was terrific reservations about this, Blacks were ready to move up into this territory, and they do.
You see estimates ranging from 200,000 African Americans pouring into mostly Harlem from 1917 to about 1925. Very soon, Harlem became for African Americans everywhere the chrysalis of the new Negro, a new opportunity.
They were wildly ambitious. They knew that New York was where you really got known. And they also knew New York was the media center, and that to the extent that integration was going to benefit them practically, the publishing industry was white. It was centered in New York.
But a lot of those promises were not lived up to. Again, Marcus Garvey advocated, as you see there, racial segregation. And he sold this idea and literally did sell it. And that's why he's going to, with his Black Star line, be put out of business and eventually deported. Twenties was the golden age of sports. War horsemen of left hand corner of Notre Dame. To the right, the seven blocks of granite from Fordham. One of the individuals on that line was a guy by the name of Vince Lombardi, who will become the legendary coach of the Green Bay Packers and after whom the Super Bowl trophy is named after. Bottom left-hand corner is Big Bill Tilden, a giant 6'8" tennis player. And then, of course, you see their old number 8, Barney Oldfield, in the beginnings of racing, car racing, auto racing, as the car starts to dominate. Celebrities during this era, well, George Herman Ruth, of course, known as the Babe. That man, Ty Cobb, one of the nastiest individuals ever in the sport of baseball. And, of course, the tradition then of throwing out the first pitch. Jack Dempsey, the Manassas Mauler. And, of course, the ultimate celebrity during the 20s, that man right there, Charles Lindbergh, and his legendary Spirit of St. Louis, which is suspended from the ceiling at the Smithsonian to this day.
He was born George Herman Ruth, but the world knew him as the Babe, one of the greatest players in the history of baseball. Babe Ruth held or shared in about 60 records, including the most home runs for a single season.
Now, what you're starting to see, think about it, the focus on individuals. Babe Ruth, Ty Cobb, Charles Lindbergh.
He was born.
Then, of course, there would be Lou Gehrig, the Iron Man. And unfortunately, the disease that's now named after him, Lou Gehrig's disease, ALS. Bobby Jones, one of the very first left-handed golfers. That man right there, the galloping ghost. For University of Illinois. And then helped inaugurate a team known as the Chicago Bears in the beginnings of a new league called the National Football League. And then, of course, the ultimate.
On May 20th, 1927, Charles Lindbergh flew his monoplane, the Spirit of St. Louis, straight into history. The first person to fly solo across the Atlantic, Lindbergh touched down in Paris 33 hours and 30 minutes after leaving New York.
Lindbergh would lose his popularity during World War II because he was against the war initially, and we'll talk more about something called the America First Committee as we get into that. But represented this idea of the rugged individual. People were losing their identity as they became faceless, nameless, cogs in the giant industrial machine where they did the same thing day after day, the same repetitive motion, the Tin Man, if you will, from The Wizard of Oz. But these individuals, whether it was Ruth or Bobby Jones or this man here, Spirit of a Nation, and of course that would be Charles Lindbergh, represented this idea that the individual still counted. So, that's the end of part one. We'll take a look at part two later on.